Okay, now our interview with Will Hild.
How long have you been with consumer research?
About over a year now. I actually took over leadership of the organization on the first day of the shutdown in Maryland. So that was an interesting, auspicious way to begin.
So are these ads your brainchild?
Yeah, you know, it was an issue that I've been following personally. And then when I got into leadership of consumers research, you know, it was just the phenomenon just exploded. And we saw more and more companies that really shouldn't be virtue signaling about anything coming out, trying to cozy up to woke politicians. And then in particular, American Airlines really, I think, is sort of the poster child for this in a lot of ways, because, you know, they go and take a multi-billion dollar taxpayer funded bailout from the COVID downturn. And then they turn around and pay their CEO, Doug Parker, eight figures that same year. And then suddenly they're taking positions on election integrity legislation and political issues that they had not been speaking on before. And I think it really typifies what this strategy is all about, what this phenomenon is all about that we're seeing in corporate America. It's an attempt to distract. They have real issues, mistreatments of their customers, in Americans' case, fleecing of the American taxpayer. And so in order to cover for that, so that they can get nice write-ups in Washington Post and New York Times, they cozy up to woke activists instead of trying to fix what's wrong with their businesses.
Well, and it smacks of just an out-and-out payoff, right? Government hands you a bunch of money, and then you do things that government wants you to do. This kind of marriage between huge U.S. corporations and the government is looking more and more like government-run companies, social, you know, which is kind of the socialism light that they've got in Europe. I mean, it's a very scary direction that we're going in. Obviously, Facebook, Google, Amazon being right at the center of a lot of that. And I want to get into all of that. But let's kind of start with the background of consumer research, what this entity is. And, you know, what came to my attention was the ads, which I think are awesome. And congratulations that was your brainchild. And I hope you guys are able to keep it going and we can help in that in some way. But let's start with, you know, what exactly is this entity, the consumer research?
Certainly. Well, Consumers Research is actually the nation's oldest consumer protection organization. It was founded in 1929. I can't say I was there, but I hope to continue the mission of the organization, which is to defend the consumer in the marketplace by educating them on issues that are important to them and then amplifying their voice. You mentioned the Consumers First Initiative as an example of this, of course, amplifying their voice in the marketplace and standing up for their concerns. And that's what we continue to do today.
So what was going on in 1929 that caused this entity to come into existence?
Absolutely. Well, the founder is a guy named Schlenk, wrote a book named 100 Million Guinea Pigs, which at the time, the U.S. population was roughly 100 million people. And he was worried that he was seeing products put out into the marketplace that clearly hadn't been tested. And so the metaphor he was using is that corporate America was using America as guinea pigs. They just put something out there and see if it works. And so the organization actually started out in the product testing space. There was a product testing lab in Washington, New Jersey, I think, that at one point employed something like 500 people to do product testing, and put out a magazine called Consumers Bulletin that had wide circulation in the United States. We actually continue that magazine to this day. It's now online at consumersbulletin.org, and where we aggregate, you know, consumer news and stuff that's important to the consumer. But over time, obviously, with the advent of the internet in the last 20, 30 years, you know, the product testing is no longer as necessary because you have, you know, you've crowdsourced it, as they say. There's, you know, Google reviews and Amazon reviews and everything like that. And so the organization, I should say, shifted strategies into helping educate consumers where their interests are at stake, or where they're going to be affected by either government policy or in this case, corporate mismanagement and mistreatment. So, you know, the Consumers First Initiative is really just born out of that desire to both protect the consumer from mistreatment, but also to amplify their voice. And we've just been overwhelmed by the emails and phone calls of people once they saw the Consumers First Initiative. They were saying, just thank you, thank you, thank you so much. Finally, somebody is standing up for the consumer, because no one likes to be preached at, by companies that are mistreating you. So it's really not about so much consumers' research or Will, certainly not about Will Hild. I think the reason this initiative has been so effective is because we're really just amplifying and putting voice to the reservoir of frustration that consumers have at many of these companies.
Well, and one thing I noticed is that I think I saw your ad on CNN. Am I correct about that? You guys have put the ad on CNN?
Yeah, we played them on a range of national channels, so I wouldn't be surprised if you saw it there. Okay. And they may have covered the story as well.
Well, I mean, you know, the left talking to the right is near impossible these days. And, you know, you don't want to preach to the choir. So I'm pretty sure I saw it on CNN, which I thought was pretty great, because CNN is certainly not an entity right now that's calling out any of these corporations. So I was kind of startled when I'm watching it. And I'm like, wait a minute, did I accidentally change the channel to Fox? Because how come I'm seeing this ad? I personally, by the way, I like to watch both. These days, I mean, you have to watch both. Mm-hmm. If you're only getting your news from MSNBC or CNN or from Fox or whatever other silo of information you get, you're not seeing the full picture.
Absolutely. And I'm glad you brought that up, because, you know, we when we launched the Consumers First Initiative, we didn't target specifically conservative media. We don't consider ourselves a conservative organization. There's certainly been both, you know, people who support what we're doing and don't like what we're doing who've labeled us that. But our sole purpose is to focus on the consumer and protecting them. And in this case, we're seeing a strategy where companies are cozying up to woke politicians and woke activists in order to cover. So I'm somewhat surprised to hear you may have seen it on CNN that they would cover that news story. So far, we've sort of heard radio silence from that side, because I just don't think, for obvious reasons, that they really want to highlight what we're doing and give voice to it. But I'm hopeful, and I certainly would accept any invitation from any media organization, even ones more aligned with the left, like CNN or MSNBC. We actually launched the initiative itself on CNBC, the business news channel, for that reason, because we consider this a business concern that consumers are being mistreated. And that's the core of the message, is the mistreatment of the customers, not so much the politics.
Mm-hmm. And who is the money behind consumers research?
Certainly. Well, we respect our supporters' right to privacy, and so we don't reveal, we don't dox our supporters. But I can say that all the people who supported this are American consumers, just like you and your viewers.
You don't have any large donors? I mean, you know, people that we would know of or other entities?
Yeah, we don't, like I said, we respect our donors' right to privacy. As you just know, you may have noted, there was just a unanimous ruling in the Supreme Court that supported the importance of anonymous giving. And so, like I said, we don't go into the details and dox those who support us, but all of our supporters are American consumers, just like you and your viewers.
Yeah, walk us through that ruling real quick, because I saw it, but didn't really read it in much detail. So what did that Supreme Court ruling really say?
Well, my understanding was that it was whether California could force certain organizations to give up donor lists and then publish those donor lists online. So effectively doxing and putting it threats, you know, effectively, because putting out people's names and addresses for supporting, you know, 501c3 nonprofits like Consumers Research. And this was opposed by pretty much the entire nonprofit community. I believe that the Southern Poverty Law Center, no less, filed an amicus brief. That's when you file, it's called friend of the court brief, when you file in support of one side or the other, filed in support of, or excuse me, against what California was doing. And so this is a pretty, you know, bipartisan, well, you know, established, you know, as a 9-0 ruling. When was the last, how rarely do we get agreement on all of the court justices? So again, I you know, we support our donors' right to privacy and respect that, but I think it goes to the importance of that.
Yeah. Well, I don't know where I come down on that one, because I certainly like to know what George Soros is up to and what he's supporting. So I'm not sure I like the idea of George Soros being able to hide behind different 501c3s in America and doing some of the stuff that he's doing. But anyway, I don't want to go down that rat hole. So, so back to the, to the ad campaign. So tell us how you came up with the concept, and how you implemented it. And I'm just curious, you know, is there anybody who's refusing to take the ads?
Absolutely. So we came up with that. As I said, we saw this phenomenon of these companies cozying up to woke politicians and woke activists in order to cover from their misdeeds. So we took a look and we saw some companies that had a wide range of problems. And they each kind of typified a different aspect of it when we first launched. So I mentioned American Airlines. I won't belabor that point, but that was an example of where they have taken taxpayer dollars and fleeced the American taxpayer to pay their CEO a ton of money and still mistreated their customers in many ways. Nike is a perfect example of this because in some ways they were the pioneer. Many people note that Nike has been going woke for a long time, but they've also had problems with forced labor in their supply chains, labor rights issues in their supply chains for a very long time. So again, it kind of plays to in some ways they pioneered this strategy. And then Coca-Cola was just such a sad example because here's a company that is American as apple pie or generally considered that by American consumers. And there they are wading into divisive political issues, taking positions on legislation like election integrity that they know nothing about. They're not election experts. And then they have issues with their supply chains. There's growing evidence that their suppliers for sugar in China use forced labor. And of course, there was the infamous example of when they sent out, in part of the trainings that they gave their employees, I guess, for, diversity sensitivity, they told their staff to be less white, which is just obviously an incredibly racist and disgusting message. So it was just really a shame. It was, it's an American icon, and to see it sell out to China in such a way and then try to cover for that and cover for its own mistreatment of its staff by going woke. We thought those three really were perfect examples of this phenomenon. And we said, we're going to diffuse the strategy. If the strategy is distract, well, we're going to shine a light on the skeletons in your closet and your mistreatment of the American consumer. So to make you focus back on that and to send a message to the rest of corporate America that this isn't going to work. If you're in, sitting in a C-suite right now, thinking about whether you should try this strategy out in order to cover or for your mistreatment of the American consumer or to just garner a nice press in the Washington Post and New York Times, we're out here saying, we're going to come for you. And so that was sort of the genesis of the campaign. And obviously we've extended it now. We ran ads against Major League Baseball for their betrayal of the American baseball fan, and against Ticketmaster, a company literally guilty of felonies in order to maintain their near monopoly position on the ticket in the ticketing industry. And then we also launched a second round of advertising against Coca-Cola as a send up of their Buy the World of Coke ad. And people can see that at alwayswokacola.com.
Yeah, no, the ads are amazing, and we'll try to provide some links to them. So, and we'll talk a little bit more about each of the companies one by one and who else may be on your target list soon. I guess a fundamental question is, why are these companies doing this to begin with? I mean, let's just take the Georgia law, for instance, which obviously is a controversial law. It's very political. It was passed by a Republican legislature and Republican governor, and the Democrats are the ones complaining about it. And Republicans say that it's perfectly reasonable law. In fact, our rules are more liberal about voting in Georgia than in most states, including Biden's state of Delaware. And you hear the left saying that, no, it's Jim Crow 2.0, and these are racist laws, and it's all to exclude. So it couldn't be more political, right? This right. Georgia voting law. And we're not going to get into the pros and cons of the Georgia voting law, just to point out that it could not be more political. And with one side saying it's okay and the other side saying that it's horrible. And yet these corporations are taking sides on this, right? And big, Major League Baseball moves the All-Star game out of there. Coca-Cola, I don't know what they did, but they're, isn't Coca-Cola, are they headquartered in Georgia?
I believe they're headquartered in Atlanta, yeah.
And Delta also, I think, mm-hmm. Is some. So anyway, it raises the question, help us out here. Why are these companies wading in to such a hotly political issue when half of Coca-Cola consumers are conservative and half of them are liberal? I mean, they're taking a stand against half of their consumers. Why are they doing this?
Well, again, I just think they've seen the strategy work for other companies. No one talks about, until recently, Nike's issues with forced labor in China. was not a widely discussed topic. And why is that? Because everyone always was talking about their issues with Colin Kaepernick and, you know, whether he should be kneeling, not be kneeling, you know, then he leaves the league and they give him the big contract to sell shoes for them. And I think they saw that work. They saw them get around some of the, you know, their issues by going woke. And then they were actively encouraging other companies to do so. And so, again, you know, you've got, again, Nike, for example, they were just on the investor call. Their CEO said that they were a company of China for China. So increasingly, these companies don't see themselves as an American brand. They'll try and sell their products that way. But when it comes to the nitty gritty of how they view themselves, you know, Nike sees itself as an international company. Coca-Cola is one of the top tier sponsors of the Beijing Olympics, which no less than Speaker Nancy Pelosi, hardly a conservative voice, right, has said that that Olympics ought to be boycotted because of the human rights abuses in China. And unfortunately, it appears that Coca-Cola is benefiting from those human rights abuses because many of their sugar suppliers may be using forced labor. So again, it sounds counterintuitive because you think, oh, well, they're going to tick off half of their customers when they do this. But look how much positive press they got. I mean, the fawning exposés by New York Times and Washington Post and ABC and NBC. I mean, they, you know, talking about, you know, corporations taking a stand and being, you know, principled. And in some ways, ticking off half their customers became another way for them in the media to praise them. Oh, they're not afraid for it to hurt their bottom line. So, you know, again, no, and this is at the same time, I should mention, so people can connect the two dots. Right now, I believe still being, you know, actively considered in Congress is a bill that would restrict access to U.S. markets from companies that are using forced labor in their supply chains. And both Nike and Coca-Cola have spent lobbying dollars trying to amend their bill so that their products would be exempted from that law. So that, I think that goes to what you're talking about there. Why would they be willing to tick off so many of their consumers? Well, because they need the help of those woke politicians. They need to be cozying up to those woke activists and those woke politicians to cover for these skeletons in their closet.
Mm-hmm. What about the leadership of these companies? Do you know? I mean, are they inherently left-leaning, the leadership of these companies, or this is more pragmatic decisions that they're making that as they look at the business climate out there, yes, we may piss off a bunch of customers, but we're going to curry favor with the right politicians?
Certainly. Well, I think it's a mix. Obviously, you know, each CEO is probably going to be different. I would imagine, I would say what's funny is that many of them have come to their political principles fairly recently. Take Ticketmaster, for example, their parent company, Live Nation, which they're sort of synonymous with, signed on to a New York Times full page letter of business leaders attacking some of this legislation that you mentioned earlier. Well, this is a company that has not been particularly politically active previous to this, and certainly not in the election space, election procedure space. This is kind of funny coming from a company that just had to pay $10 million criminal fine for hacking into the computers of one of its competitors, Songkick, and keeping consumers from seeing a lower priced alternative to Ticketmaster. And subsequently, Songkick went out of business. So, you know, this is a company that's out there committing criminal felonies in order to maintain what is a near monopoly position. And the FTC itself has had to take enforcement action against Live Nation for its anti-competitive practices. And suddenly, while they're paying criminal fines, they want to go out and virtue signal about election integrity legislation. So I think that tells you, you know, regardless of the individual political leanings of the CEOs, that would kind of be hard to tell without knowing these people personally. When the companies get involved, it seems to be for very cynical and self-interested reasons.
Yeah, I mean, so if you've been out there supporting the woke causes, perhaps they feel like Biden's FTC is less likely to be aggressive with them or whatever the regulatory body is. Exactly. You know, if you're concerned about being broken up, it's that you're concerned about being regulated. If you're doing what the politicians want and you're friends to them, not to mention also obviously campaign contributions, et cetera, but it's kind of another form of campaign contribution. It's campaign contributions plus going out there and actually campaigning for their causes.
Exactly. I think, you know, companies have always, is a well-known phenomenon, well-documented phenomenon. Companies have generally given to both sides whoever was I think the number one thing they give to is incumbents. It's not so much party. It's just they want to have access when they have an issue with their business, with a regulatory issue or a legislative issue. They want to be able to at least pick up the phone and have that person answer them. I think what's different here is in the past, these companies have focused, right or wrong, on things that were germane to what they were doing. So if you're, you know, if you're an airline, you know, you're worried about FAA regulations and gas regulations and that kind of thing. As you noted, I think what's new about this phenomenon is, I think you put it perfectly, it's a new type of campaign contribution, and they've picked a side that they think can help them more. And in the case of American Airlines, for example, I mean, they may very well need another bailout. And so this is a great way to curry additional favor so that, you know, when they need a ton more money so they can keep Doug Parker, you know, paychecks rolling, you know, they'll have a friendly ear.
But something tells me that if Republicans were to take back control of the federal government, that they would not be doing the same thing for causes on the right.
Well, I think we're going to, I'm happy to do so, but I think we'll get a little bit of deep weeds on public choice theory here. You say Republicans take control, and many of the decisions, you noted the FTC, I said the FAA, many of these are staffed by lifelong bureaucrats that do not change out when there are elections. And so it's, you know, whichever party, and currently right now it's the Democrats, controls that lifelong bureaucracy, has political power that is not necessarily, you know, shown up in the exact makeup of the Senate and Congress. So I think you're right in your, you know, obviously we won't know until that would happen, but I think your intuition is probably correct. But it has to do with the makeup of the bureaucracy, and Washington is a pretty much a one party town when it comes to the bureaucrats that work and live here.
Yeah, well, that's a great point that I think a lot of people who don't work and live there don't realize. Some sort of call that the deep state, I guess. But yeah, if you look at the party affiliation in the surrounding area of DC, walk me through that. Isn't it extremely heavily
overwhelmingly? I think I think DC voted, I think in 2016, I think it voted 97% for Hillary Clinton. So, you know, I don't know if the county of wherever Berkeley, the county that Berkeley, California sits, voted that stringently in one direction. So you really have it's a very small town mentality here in DC, and obviously it's a major city, but you know, it's kind of got a uniform culture and a uniform political worldview, and many of those people are those staffing the bureaucracies, and they make many of the decisions that are important to these companies. So even though you might think, oh, well, they'll be out of luck if Republicans were to take office, or they'd have to shift gears and start, you know, I don't know, virtue signaling about Republican issues. They won't, because the people that they really need to suck up to, in addition to the woke politicians, are the woke bureaucrats.
Well, and how much of it also is these companies fearing cancel culture, that if they don't say just the right thing, that the woke cancel culture mob will come after them? There isn't really a mob from the right that's going to come out and criticize you, but if you don't say and do the right things, there's the cancel culture mob that may come for you.
Well, I will say Consumers First Initiative will come for you, but
well, now, but
I will say that, it's hard to measure, and I don't want to overgeneralize. I'm sure there's cases of companies that feel that they were bullied into taking some of these positions. Often I feel like the CEOs, it's another aspect of their cynical ploy. For example, Doug Parker said that part of the reason he had American Airlines, he and American Airlines took the position that they did, was because he was hearing from many of his staff. Well, that's kind of laughable from a guy who just laid off 19,000 people from his own company after he took government bailout money to keep as many of them as employed as possible. I would imagine that if you were to poll those 19,000 people that he laid off and asked, would you have preferred he spend more time making sure the company was on sure footing or engaging in politics so that you could maybe have a better chance at having kept your job? They would say they really don't really want Doug Parker in politics. So certainly in any company that large, you could point to someone and say, well, this person's woke and I'm just doing what they're, you know, making me do. But, you know, in companies as large as this, they're probably going to make up, you know, they're going to roughly look like the rest of the country, especially company, you know, based, you know, nationwide like American. So it seems awfully disingenuous. It's pretty amazing that they take this cynical ploy of trying to cover and distract from their own issues. And then when somebody tries to say, hey, well, why did you do this? They don't even have the courage to take it upon themselves to say that they made the decision. They try to act like they were forced to it by their employees whose paycheck they signed. So I just think it's kind of an incredibly cowardly and disingenuous position for the CEO of a company to say he was forced by people he could hire and fire to do something.
But you do think it's very calculated and done ultimately for business reasons. They think it is in their business interest to come out as woke, as opposed to a CEO making the individual decision that he wants to appear woke.
Yeah, that very well may be part of it. Again, we're talking about hundreds of CEOs, so I can't speak for every one of them. I think in the cases that we've specifically highlighted, it's pretty obvious that it's a cynical ploy. But, you know, to the extent there are CEOs that want to go out there and do that, you know, it's also somewhat disingenuous to drag your company into that. It's one thing to come out and say, you know, me personally, I, Will Hill, believe X, Y, or Z. But then to say, you know, my whole company supports X, Y, or Z, you know, maybe your company's four people and you've asked them all. But especially when it's a multi, you know, kind of like what you noted with Coca-Cola, their consumers are ostensibly at least half conservative, right? And in many of these companies that they pretend to speak for all of their staff, in fact, say, as you noted, that they're speaking for their staff, that they were dragged into this by their staff. It's just, it's awfully disingenuous and cowardly.
Have you seen any CEOs or heads of companies come out and say, you know, we're not in the business of politics. We're in the business of making donuts or whatever product. And we're not going to weigh in on these issues.
I haven't, none come to mind exactly. I'm sure there have been some, but you imagine you probably wouldn't issue like a statement about that. You just continue focus on what you should be, which is serving the American consumer. Mm-hmm. You wouldn't be virtuing signaling about how you're not virtue signaling.
Yeah. Well, I guess I'm just thinking in response, because a lot of times they're getting pressured to take positions, mm-hmm. you know, so let's say.
Well, there was Basecamp. I know the CEO there, they were having issues with politics taking over the majority of conversations. They had, and they noted staff that felt uncomfortable with it. So, you know, to the extent there is push in the woke direction from employees, there's, you know, people who don't want to have that in their workplace as well. And I know that they took a stand and said that, you know, listen, we're a business. We're here to serve our customers and serve our consumers. And we welcome, you know, certainly don't restrict our employees' rights to discuss politics on their own time. But when you're here working for the company, you work for the customer. And that's who you need to be focused on.
Yeah. I mean, that's what I would like to see coming from these companies. When I ran a company, that certainly would be my position, is that, you know, if employees, you know, you have a lot of young woke employees at these companies expecting, you know, especially in Silicon Valley, expecting their company to do these things. In fact, you know, it's one of the big interview questions, I think, for the, you know, millennials is ask, you know, finding out, okay, what does the company do on this issue and that issue? You know, is it doing all the correct woke things? And there's this kind of pressure from below. You know, you referenced it, that some of them saying it's coming from employees. I think a lot of some of it, they're correct. It does come from their millennial employees. You know, I mean, if you look at millennials and their voting record in, you know, voting like 85% for Bernie Sanders, that tells you what the young generation in general is thinking.
Well, I haven't seen the stats that they voted 85% for Bernie Sanders, but I can say I think a lot of this is pushed by consulting firms that want to tell companies what millennials are looking for. You know, I am a millennial. Obviously, this is anecdotal, but I've, you know, traveled around. I have broad swath of friends on left, right, you know, up, down, lots of different political positions. And none of them have ever mentioned that to me. Usually when they tell me they got a job offer, it's exclusively the details of the pay and the benefits and how excited they are for, I don't know, working 4 days a week or whatever. That's what they're concerned about. I've never had a friend tell me, yeah, I really am excited that they take up my exact, you know, nuanced position on this political issue.
Well, I mean, yeah, but I think it's there. I think it's real. I'm remembering back to the days when I was interviewing at law firms back in the early 90s, coming out of law school. And the ones, and again, maybe this is a California thing, maybe it's a San Francisco thing, because I was interviewing in LA and San Francisco, two very liberal towns, but they were kind of falling over themselves to talk about all the liberal causes that they support and this and that. They really thought that that was, you know, a banner to hold high.
Well, I will say you are seeing one bizarre example of this, and that Google, I think, just had an employees union form, but for the expressly not for the purpose of advocating for better wages, better benefits, more vacation for their staff, but simply as a cudgel to go after other employees that they did not think held the same views that they did. And so, you know, it may be a good example of what you're talking about there. And certainly Silicon Valley is a sort of its own strange microcosm culture, much like I mentioned DC is. So like I said, I don't say 100% that there's no employees that want certain companies to take certain positions. But I think broadly speaking, when you've got companies like American, like Coca-Cola, that have staff and from across the country, stationed in a lot of states that lean, you know, more conservative, it's unlikely that they, you know, polled the whole company and found an overwhelming position was desired.
Yeah, well, and it's also, you know, cancel culture keeps one side quiet and the other one feels totally free to announce their views on things. So they're, right, they appear to be larger than they are. I was just having a conversation with an old friend from my old law firm who was saying that, you know, during the election cycle, you know, all the associates are texting about Biden this and Biden that and wearing their buttons and this and that. But certainly, right, if you supported Trump,
like Coca-Cola may have inadvertently created an echo chamber and a selection bias. So, you know, I mentioned before they sent out that just incredibly racist statement to their employees to be less white. Well, if you're a conservative, what message does that send to you that you should speak up about anything that you believe? You might be putting your job at stake. Whereas somebody who has an opposing view, it tells them, yeah, go shout it at the rooftop. So it may be that the CEOs are creating this problem, and then again, it's power petitioning itself. Yeah, everyone that tells, you know, it's like the emperor with no clothes. Yeah, everyone tells me my clothes look great, right? Because I killed the last three guys that told me I was naked.
Well, and let me tell you another little anecdotal example, and that is I was looking at some of the criteria of positions with any of the universities, you know, professor positions at any of the California universities, whether it be UC, Cal State, or community colleges, and they all require you to produce an equity statement. And this is, they want to know all the things that you've done to support diversity, equity, and inclusion in your life. And you're kind of like, well, I don't believe in equity as you guys define it, because we all know equality and equity is something different. We've talked about that on the show. It's essentially affirmative action is equity. I don't believe in affirmative action. So basically, need not apply. Don't bother applying. And it wouldn't surprise me at all if there's a lot of private companies that are requiring people applying for jobs to submit their equity and diversity statement about all you've done in your life to show that your commitment to equity and diversity. So in that sense, they're self-selecting.
Absolutely. And, you know, I won't go into labor issues there. I am a lawyer, but I'm not that kind of lawyer. But I can only imagine some of these stuff, I mean, just basic, you know, employment law 101 that you learn in law school seems to fly in the face of that. I'm kind of blown away that these companies so far have managed to miss any major class action activity. Again, the Coca-Cola, you know, telling all your employees to be less white. Can you imagine the lawsuit that would be institute any, put any other color in that sentence, and Coca-Cola would be writing a very large check to solve for that. So, you know, some of these companies are doing things that I think they are, you know, they're gambling Because I think eventually one of them is going to be facing a very serious lawsuit that's going to cost them a lot of money.
Well, they're all practicing affirmative action. I can tell you that. And affirmative action is illegal. That is discrimination based upon race. The only legitimate affirmative action is if in a court of law, it's essentially been proven that you previously discriminated against a particular group, and then you're permitted to use affirmative action to, respond to that. But right. Otherwise, affirmative action is 1,000% illegal, yet all the companies are doing it.
Right, right. So, yeah, and again, I'm not an expert in that area of law, so I can't tell you, you know, what's coming down the pipe on that. But I would expect that as these companies sort of fall all over themselves to cozy up to woke politicians and woke activists to do this stuff, it does not look to me like they are crossing their T's and dotting their I's in a legal sense, and they are probably going to live to regret it. These types of lawsuits take years to develop. So, you know, often, you know, as you know, from I'm sure following litigation, it can take, you know, 2-3 years down the line before you start to see something. I would expect we'll probably start to see some of those things start to develop shortly.
So who is coming up next, if you can reveal for us on your list?
I'm afraid we keep that close to the vest. We certainly don't want to tip off targets that we're coming after them. But I can say that this is a 7-figure ongoing ad campaign. We are not going away. We are going to continue to name and shame these companies until we see this phenomenon end. They need to be focused on their customers, focused on serving the American consumer, not on cozying up to woke politicians.
Have you gotten any feedback from the companies that you've gone after?
Coca-Cola put out a very like milquetoast statement. It was kind of ironic because they continued to preach to the American people about politics. They basically said that some sort of vanilla statement about respecting everyone's right to talk, but think they should do so in a respectful manner, which was obviously kind of a passive aggressive swipe at us. To me, it's just incredibly more of the same, right? So they get caught betraying their consumers, mistreating them. And then their defense is, well, we think people should speak, but speak so respectfully. Well, I'm sure they would like if I speak more respectfully about their tarnished brand. But other than that, I think American just referred back to their original statement. I doubt many of these companies want to draw more attention to it by responding to it. But we're not going to go away. They're probably hoping that this will all just kind of fizzle out, but we're in it for the long haul.
Is the issue of social media censorship something that concerns you guys and that you would essentially put into this category?
Yeah, it's certainly on the table. We consider that a very deep betrayal of the consumer. Many people join these platforms and in the good faith, you know, many of these companies advertise them as a place for people to meet and discuss ideas and to be a public forum where these kinds of things could be discussed. And then they seem to change the rules ad hoc on the fly. Based on, again, cozying up to bureaucrats. I mean, you see how Twitter sort of follows whatever the CDC is saying, I would say as of this week, but, you know, it could be every minute with them. And it goes kind of back to the bureaucrat thing. It's definitely on the radar.
Yeah, well, and now you've got, you know, the government basically asking them to be censoring. They're almost threatening these groups, saying that, look, if you don't do a better job of censoring what we consider to be misinformation, we may need to change the laws on you. We may need to change Section 230 right. on you. So right. Here's government pressuring these companies to do what it wants.
Absolutely.
Or we're going to come after you.
No, it's a perfect example, right? They are literally out there cozying up to woke politicians to betray the American consumer that they supposedly serve. So you bring up a great point. It's a perfect example of this phenomenon.
Mm-hmm. Are those, you know, the big three, Facebook, Google, Amazon, are they too big for you guys to take on?
Well, no one's too big for us. But we will, like I said, we don't get into the details of who's coming next because we don't want to give anybody tips off, but we will continue to move forward and criticize this phenomenon as we see it.
Okay. Well, I love what you guys are doing. So keep it up. And how can people support you?
Certainly. Well, people would like to learn more and support us, you can visit us at consumersresearch.org. That's consumersresearch.org.
Thank you again to Will Hild, Executive Director of Consumers Research. You can check out all of their great work online, Consumers Research website. Thank you to Michael Parker, our producer. And thank you all for listening. We'll be back soon with another episode of The Hidden Truth Show. Thank you.
Thank you for listening to the Hidden Truth Show with Jim Breslow. You can find us at hiddentruthshow.com. Follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Hidden Truth Show. Join us again next week for another episode of Hidden Truth Show with Jim Breslow.